It is June the 22nd, 1998. This is the interview with the survivor Adela Boddy, maiden name Vershubska. The interviewer is Joanna Buchan. The interview is taking place in Glasgow, in Scotland, in the UK. And the language of this interview will be English. My name is Joanna Buchan, B-U-C-H-A-N. I'm conducting an interview with the survivor Adela Boddy, maiden name Vershubska, that's spelt V-I-R-S-Z-U-B-S-K-A. The interview is taking place in Glasgow, in Scotland, in the UK, on the 22nd of June 1998, and the language of this interview will be English. And could you tell me your name, please?
My name is Ada Boddy, and my maiden name is Vershubska.
Could you spell that for me?
W-I-R-S-Z-U-B-S-K-A.
And what's your date of birth?
Well, delicate question. 22nd of June, which is today, my birthday, 1935.
And how old are you today?
Well, 35 from 98 makes it 63.
And where were you born?
I was born in Brest-Litovsk, which is now part of Russia. But when I was born, it was Poland.
And what was your father's name?
My father's was called Aaron Vershubsky. I at the end, rather than A for masculine.
And where was he born?
He was born in a little village, and the name escapes me, but it's written down, in the district of Grodno. There is more specific location, but I forget at the moment.
And was that in Poland or Russia? Or?
Well, he was born in 1904, so it was part of Russia.
And what was your mother's name?
My mother was called Eugenia. Everybody called her Genia. Dvorak. She was born in Vilno. She was part of a very big family. Do you want me to go on about it? Or not
I'll,
yet?
I'll ask you something about the lady. Vilno, where is that?
Vilnius. It's in Lithuania. It's a capital of Lithuania.
And do you have any brothers or sisters?
I have a sister who lives in Warsaw, in Poland.
And what's her name?
Her name is Regina, R-E-G-I-N-A, Vershubska, Ni Vershubska. Her married name is very Polish name, Szymańska, S-Z-Y-M-A-N-S-K-A.
Start the interview really by talking about your childhood and what you remember of growing up. What do you remember of family life when you think of when you were very young, growing up?
I don't remember very much from before the war, although maybe I should. I have very vague memory of birthday party for my sister, but it's really not clear in my mind. I remember mostly, I have few very strong memories. One was when we were living in Hajnówka under Russians, when we left our proper home, which was in Wysokie Litewskie, and we lived in one room. This was between 1939 and 41, and there was no bathroom. And I remember my father standing naked, that made an impression, in a kind of like a bowl of water, and my mother shouting for us not to look while she was washing him or pouring water. I also remember very vividly the day my father died. This is war years already.
You said you remembered your sister's birthday party. When was your sister born?
She was born in 1933 or 1932, which is another debating thing. I don't know whether I remember it or whether she told me, because she remembers that our father was teaching us English by reading English poetry to us, and the way we were sitting on his knees, on one knee. I vaguely remember going to my grandmother's house. Actually, I remember more than I remembered a minute ago, which was in Vilnius.
Was this your mother's mother?
My mother's mother. That is quite a strong memory because it was a very big family, and I remember the atmosphere more than the facts.
What was it like, the atmosphere?
Well, my grandmother was had, I think, 8 children or more. I'm not sure about the 2. I can count them and name them if you would like me to, or not yet. Shall I?
Go ahead.
Well, my mother was the oldest of 5 girls. She, and after her came Ciocia, or auntie, Gita. Then there was auntie Cilla and auntie Nura, Eugenia, Gita, Nura, Cilla, Ola. Ola was the youngest from my grandmother's second marriage. And there were 2 uncles, Uncle Zelman and Uncle Fima, who was gay. Yes, was a big secret in the family, who was absolutely wonderful. And I have memories going to the park with him, and I actually have a photograph holding 2 hands. I also remember sleeping arrangements, which were, because there were so many people and there were 3 or 4 of us, that we slept on stove, or kind of alcove in the stove, because it was warm, so the children slept in that. Also remember smells of all the wonderful things like gefilte fish and what have you, all the nice Jewish food.
Was your grandmother very observant in her family life?
I don't really know. I think she was widowed with 4 daughters, and maybe I think one of her sons ran away in 1917 to join the Russian Revolution. Nobody ever heard from him. And I'm not sure whether there were 2 brothers who ran away. And she was widowed before she was 30. So you can imagine how frequently she had children. And then she had to work. And she had a bathhouse in which my mother and all the other children, especially girls, had to help. And one of the things that my mother had to do as a young child, she talked about it a lot, was to go and, you know how in Russian public bathhouses, they use twigs to get the circulation going. And that was her job. And the men who came to the bathhouse were usually old, and they seemed to her old and terrible. And then she had to pour water, hot and cold water, to cool them down. She remembered this as a very unpleasant part of her growing up. So I don't think there was very much time for religion, but there was time for holidays, because we went, I think the time when we went was for Passover, which was obviously strictly observed. I think life temporarily improved when my grandmother remarried and had her last child, Ola, who was, they were very proud of it. She was the only educated, she started going to Vilnius University. But she left after first year, and you will be interested in it, because she was a beautiful girl, I have her photograph, non-Semitic looking, and everything was just fantastic. But she was Jewish, and the anti-Semitism made her leave the university after the first year. And she was the baby in the family. Everybody loved her. So...
Do you remember anything else about that visit to your grandmother's for Passover?
No, I don't. I just remember being hugged and loved and jolted. And I just remember that came and went very quickly in my life.
Did you keep the holidays at home, dear?
Before the war?
Parents and
yes,
before?
Yes, of course. I don't remember much about it, but I remember my grandfather's visit, the rabbi, my father's father, who came to Wysoki Litewski for one of the holidays. I don't know why his wife didn't come. I don't remember her at all. And I remember this man in black sitting at the head of the table and having to whisper and you know, do all the rituals. Yes.
What was your grandfather's name?
I don't remember. Wilshubski. Very non-Jewish name, and that's what he was called.
Where was he rabbi? Do you know?
He was rabbi in Skidel. Skidel Litewski, I think it was called. Yes.
And is that where your father was born?
Yes, somewhere around, maybe smaller place. I have no information about how my grandfather on my father's side died at all. They might have been taken to the ghetto or wiped up before even ghetto. Who knows? We just don't know.
What sort of person was your father? What do you think of when you think of your father when you were growing up?
I don't know about growing up, but I had, up to quite recently, I had a reoccurring dream that my father was walking toward me, and just as he was quite near, I'm going to cry, he would disappear. So, obviously, you know, if you think how old I was in 1941, I still hunger for this father figure. It's quite a memory. I know about my father only stories that my mother told me and my sister. That he was studious, that he always read, that he didn't talk much. That my mother tried very hard to keep up with him because he was the educated intellectual, and she told us that she was a student, and that's how they met. But I think, my sister and I think it's not true, that she went just to dances to meet the boys. And that's how the girls, all the girls married very well.
What did your father do for a living?
He was a judge at first. And then he wasn't really very comfortable with it, although it was a big honor for a Jew to be a judge. It wasn't a very common thing. But I think they dealt a lot with... I think he was a criminal court judge. And there were a lot of violent cases involving peasants. Remember, it was a rural community. So there were threats. And also judges were paid very little. So I don't know how the decision was taken, but he moved. Usually the move was from being an advocate or barrister to be a judge. He did the other way around. And I think financial situation has improved after that considerably.
What sort of house did you live in before the war?
My parents bought a house in Brest-Litovsk in 1939, which my sister just visited for a long, after first time since we left that in 39. It was bought and they lost it immediately to the Russians. And we always thought as being a very big house. But she said it's not that big, although it has up and down. And it was requisitioned by the Russians. And I remember from that time that when we were told to move out and we were standing waiting, that the Russians burned my father's books. They just got, instead of getting rid of it, they just burned it in the yard.
And you saw all that?
Yes, I remember that. Because
did you
it
have
was
to
quite traumatic.
Did you have to pack up for yourself? Were you allowed to take things with you?
I think probably very little, because we moved from a house which I suspect would have 3 or 4 bedrooms and salon, as they called it, and a dining room and a big kitchen. And we moved to a one-room place where my father was made déclassé. The Russians wouldn't allow him to practice law, so he worked as a what they call buchhalter, accountant for the Russians. And I think we had very little possessions. I don't remember having any toys at all until the war, when I remember having my first doll, which I got from a German.
Do you remember at the time, did you do anything with your sister? Were you close to your sister?
I remember, I don't remember the time before the war. I remember after 1941. My sister, the little town where we lived had sort of 3 prominent people in it. The postmaster, the priest, and the schoolmaster. And I don't know, one of them gave my sister a bicycle. And I remember running after the bicycle while she proudly drove. But she also taught me to read during the war. And we had no books, no children books, no schooling. So the only books that we had were the books that were in this house where we stayed, or maybe somebody lent it to my mother. But I remember she taught me to read on Anna Karenina. It was my first book. Still love it. Still try to live my life like that. Tragic Anna Karenina. So I remember that. And I also remember the horror when she broke her arm. She fell off the bicycle. And it was during the time when there was an uprising in Białystok ghetto. And my mother took her to the hospital there to deal with her hand. And I was quite devastated because I was left with the postmistress lady looking after her newly born child. And missing my sister and being afraid that they won't come back. My sister remembers looking at the shooting from the hospital window.
Whereabouts were you living then when that happened?
We were in Narev. This is the place where we ran away from the Pruzhane ghetto and we stayed there.
Your parents had bought the house in Brest-Litovsk. What happened to you? You were put into one room when they lost the house. What happened to you after that?
Well, we stayed there probably for about 2 years, I think, when on the 22nd of June 1941, the Germans invaded Russia, and we had to leave. We had to run. And I think we went to Wysoki Litevski, where we stayed with a family which my parents were friendly. They gave us a shelter, and Germans were already there. After that, Wysoki Litewski was not... I'm getting confused now. Well, I think maybe, I don't remember which came first, Wysoki Litewski or Hajnówka. After Germans came, not very long, I don't remember. Well, if they invaded in June 1941, by September, around September 4th, that I remember very vividly. We were told to gather on the at the sort of market square, and we were told that they were evacuating us to Pruszany for some reason. I don't know the reason. I don't remember the reason. And lorries were brought in, and women and children were put on the lorries, and the men had to run from Hajnówka to Pruszany. They had to follow the path on foot.
Who was doing the rounding up? Who told you?
The Germans.
Who ordered the Germans?
The Germans, yes. The German Gestapo.
Were you marked out as Jewish in any way?
I think they announced that we probably, I suspect we already had stars as soon as they arrived. Or they had pretty good list of who were Jewish. There was no way of not doing it. And perhaps we could have run away the night before, if who knows. I think there was still strong belief that there was very little information of what was going on between 39 and 41 in the invaded places already in Poland. I don't know. I think that was the night, perhaps, that my mother said to my father, let's go to the forest. And he said, let's stay with the Germans. Probably. Excuse me. Well, the long and the short story of it is that he never arrived. And I remember this very well.
Your father never arrived?
He never arrived. We stayed at the edge, we stayed on the outskirts of town, and as the men were arriving, the women were running forward, and the children were running forward, and we were standing and standing, and my father wasn't coming. I think maybe about 60 people didn't come. I don't know exactly the number of men who didn't come. What happened, and we found out from the survivors, that as the men who were, let's say somebody lost glasses, like my father, who couldn't see, they were, the one that were still on their feet were told to bury the one who were falling and who were shot. If a man fell, he was shot. And the one that was still alive had to bury him, and of course, and then catch up with the rest, which wasn't possible. And I think my father was one of the one that was told to bury somebody else. And that was that. So I remember that day very well. I wet my pants, I think I remember that. And my sister was very solicitous, and my mother was not in condition to do anything, so that was it.
That's how the old day. Were you then?
Well, 41, 35, 6.
And where did you have to go next once you'd arrived in
the village?
I think
they gathered us in synagogue. And I remember all these people on sort of bits of clothing that they grabbed, lying and crying. There was a lot, there was like a wall of tears from this building. It was well, What happened after that, that I think we were allocated some sort of accommodation, but my mother, who was in some ways sharper than my father, well, she always said education, she brought me on this philosophy, education is not everything. You have to use your common sense. I think because there were lots of people that knew my father as his clients, and it was all in the same area, she gathered, the ghetto was nearly, it was closed ghetto. She was blue-eyed, brunette, but she had non-Semitic looks, turn-up nose, and with the name Virshubska. She collected signatures, and I don't know how she did it, which stated that she was not Jewish, that my father was called Virshubsky because he adopted her name in order to practice law. And 20 people signed that, non-Jews. And on the strength of that, why did it have to happen during the night? I don't know. We were let out, and one of my mother's friends or acquaintances or who knows, waited with a wagon, with a straw and a horse. And we got out at night, got under the straw and drove off to freedom, quote.
And we've just come to the end of the first tape there.
Perfect timing.
And this is tape number 2 of the interview with the survivor, Mrs. Adela Boddy. We were talking there about the ghetto that you and your mother and sister had been taken to. What was it called?
It was called Pruzhany, Pruzhany.
Did you have false papers to leave the ghetto?
Well, we have this piece of paper, which was, as I said before, signed. I think my mother had some identification papers which were issued by the Russians and which she altered in some ways, changing my father's name to Anatol from Aaron, removing Dvorak as her maiden name. I think she alternated between calling herself Dvorecka, which was with Polish ending, or using her mother's second married name, Borisevich. But I don't think any a single day after we moved to this place called Narev, N-A-R-E-V, on the river Narev, which now it's a Polish small town. My sister visited recently, and I probably will go to see it too. I don't really know what kind of explanation she gave it to the people in the village, but we lived with a farmer, a small farmer, and one of the things that she did, which caused us a lot of heartache And I even wrote a short story about it, which I have upstairs. I can give it to you slightly altered. She left us for a day on this farm, and she went to another town to steal paraphernalia from church, a cross, a prayer book, which she displayed then in the room of the peasant. It was a very dangerous thing to do, probably less dangerous than she thought. But she came, and I remember that her hands were shaking and her heart was beating very hard. And she was telling us, children, you are now Christian girls, and you went to church, and we learned how to say prayers, and we went to church every Sunday religiously, and every day, if there was no one around, we would go outside and look at the sky, and she would say, thank God for another day, which we were allowed to live, that nobody denounced us, because that was the way to go. And it didn't happen. And she was a very resourceful woman. She found she had to make some money or to live on something. The main thing was to get food. And she found a job as a cook for Gestapo headquarters. I suppose there was a small Gestapo. And she went there and she cooked and she stole food because there was a shortage of food. So she would bring a piece of sausage under her shirt. And that was a very dangerous thing to do, because if she were caught, one thing could lead to another. Not only she would be caught and sort of pronounced a thief, but it could lead to investigation who she actually was.
What were you doing while your mother was working, going to work?
I think just playing, helping the farmer, weeding, feeding horses, which I still dislike, I'm afraid to say, because I was afraid. I was little and the horse was big, and we weren't brought up in this rural way of life. And
was there any schooling at all?
No, there was no school at all for us. I don't know what the other children did. I suspect that the Catholic children were also taught at home, if they were taught at all. I don't remember seeing a children's books at all during this period. I remember Tolstoy, I remember Mickiewicz, maybe Pantaleusz, or sort of classic books that were found in every home, even not very literate homes. I don't remember much about it. I remember my sister, her hair was dyed, her nose is longer than mine, so she was blonde. I don't know how my mother got peroxide to do it, but her hair was made.
What color was your hair?
My hair was dark, brown hair, blackish, but I had sort of not very Semitic looks, while my sister was much more Semitic looking. Longish nose, bigger ears, the usual thing what the Germans were looking for.
Was it hard for you to stop being Jewish, to pretend to be Christian?
I think when you are afraid, the question of who you are doesn't enter into this equation. You just have to do what, as a child, what you are told to do, because it's dangerous. It's like being told not to cross the road. Being Jewish was not a safe thing to say. We were taught to lie about our father and about our grandmothers, about the whole family. We weren't allowed to mention that the aunt would be called Gita. We were allowed to mention Ola, because it's short for Alexandra, and that's a Russian Polish name. Nura was a Russian name, so Nura was all right, but Sila was not, because that was like Sicily, it's more Jewish name. Also, Zalman was typically Jewish name, but Fimka was a Russian name. So there were all kinds of rules that we had to obey.
Were you able to mix with other children at all?
I'm sure we did, yes. Yes. We went to visit the priest. We went for church instructions. We weren't baptized, but we were confirmed because we were at the age of confirmation. And I think my mother had to go and, I don't know how she had to get white dresses for us. And we were confirmed. I was confirmed Teresa. And I don't know my sister's confirmation name. Maybe she escaped it. I just don't know.
What do you remember of your confirmation?
Having to say Hail Mary and all the other things, and I don't know the equivalent of English names, but the two basic prayers, I'm sure. And sing. But as a child, you learn very quickly. They're like poems and songs.
How old were you when you were confirmed?
Probably 1943 or something like that. Might have been 9 or 10 or something like that, 8. 8, probably.
Were you confirmed alone?
I think there were a lot of children there. But we went to the communion and we went to confessions. And we had to sit at night and make up sins, because we didn't really know what sins were or how what sin was. And then we learned, because we talked to other children. What kind of sins did you have? And they say, oh, I was rude to my mother, and I used bad word, and so on. So it was, every week was the same thing. We went to weekly confessions.
And did you go to Mass on Sundays?
Probably, yes, I'm sure we did. I'm sure we did. But we always knew that in our hearts that we were playing the game, we were pretending. And we had to be very careful when the Germans were walking by to smile, and my sister would go to the back of the farm because it was more dangerous for her to be seen than for me. Although during that time my mother became friendly not with the Gestapo but with a soldier who was one of the nice Germans. And that's how I got my first doll. And I have a picture of my first doll and the German. For Christmas, he went home to Germany and brought us presents. But we knew that he was a good German. He wasn't just a good man. He was unique. It was a very big moment, a very big lesson in tolerance, that not all Germans were bastards. So I remember that. And as I told you before, I remember the day when my sister came back with my mother after her broken hand was fixed in the Bialystok hospital during the Bialystok uprising. And my mother forbid her, my sister, to look out the window. She didn't want her to have any feelings of what's going on, but my sister didn't know what was going on. And it was pretty terrible, but we were saying how lucky we are we could have been there.
So did your sister tell you when she got back what she saw?
Yes. She heard the bullets, and she saw the flashing of the bullets going over the wall.
Do you remember the name of the good German who gave you the doll?
No. Could have been Hans or Klaus, or no, I don't know.
Did you see him again?
No. But I think he was that his visits lasted for quite some time. And there was a romance attached to it because we were friendly with, or we were befriended by the wife of the postmistress who sheltered me while my mother went there. And maybe the German had was a bit sweet on her, on this woman, so he hung about. They did, none of them knew that we were Jewish, or we thought they didn't. Perhaps they did.
Did anyone suspect, do you think? Was there any suspicion about the family?
Nobody made any move toward it, because it would have been very simple just to go to the Gestapo and say they are Jews, and that would be it. But it didn't happen, so we don't know.
Had you been aware of anti-Semitism at all when, say, before the war broke out, when you were little?
I'm not sure at what point my mother told us about her sister, her younger sister, who was not allowed to study. So we knew, but I don't remember being different or being ostracized or being minority. I don't remember that. But then I was very little, I think my sister's friends were Jewish and non-Jewish. I think she has a photograph from her school days, and it looks like a very happy.
During this time, were you waiting to hear from your father?
No, we knew that he was dead. But as a child, I perhaps hoped that it wasn't true. The graves were disappeared. People went to look to be able to move them to another place. And my sister went with a group of people. I think she hired some Russians, who, even the older generation of Russians, who lived nearby. And there is absolutely, it's a road, there's no way finding the graves unless somebody dug out the whole 20 kilometers. So it's not even a mass grave, it's really just buried by roadside. My mother was much more level-headed about it, and she learned during the period between 41 and 44 that the whole family in Vilnius was just disappeared in one day, because they were taken to a it's a well-known fact, they were taken to a park in Vilnius called Panari. Jewish ghetto didn't last very long in Vilnius, and they were just massacred, and my mother knew about it, so she lost the entire family, the brothers and sisters who were married, who had children, and she might have heard about my father's family, but she wasn't that close to them, so I think maybe her sorrow was concentrated on her own family.
So when did she tell you what had happened to them?
She told us probably as soon as she knew that Granny is dead and all the aunts are dead. There was nothing. We weren't protected as you would protect children now. Death was occurring in all kinds of ways, not just by that, by bombing and later on. So, but that was a very, what I remember my mother saying is, we are all alone, there are just three of us left. So it was kind of thing that we remembered. Well, there are good things come out of it. The three of us grew up very, very close. Very supportive and small but very nice family.
Were you living in the same place throughout this time with the within the farm?
Yes, yes. I think we moved briefly because his little farm was next to church, and when the war started, really, where the front was coming nearer, there was a bombing, and the village was bombed. Several bombs were dropped. One of them was on the, what do you call it, where the priest lived, the bit that's attached to the church. What is it called?
It's a vicarage or a...
Vicarage, something like a vicarage. Well, the bomb fell there. Nobody actually got killed. So we moved briefly to, I think, the postmistress. I don't have many memories. I remember my sister, and I remember having to babysit for a little child in a dark room, being a little girl myself, having to rock the cradle in the dark and being very frightened, and the child crying, the child asleep. And I just couldn't stand being there anymore, and remember pinching the baby so that it would cry, and then frightened of being found out. So it was just, in some ways, it was probably abnormally normal childhood.
Were you hungry?
Never. Never hungry. No, we had vegetables from the farmer and potatoes. There was probably distinct difficulties about what we would call protein, meat and eggs, because the Germans were confiscating everything that would go to the army. This is why the stealing was so necessary. No, never hungry. Just frightened. Always, always frightened.
Was there much contact with the Germans?
Well, my mother had daily contact, which was very frightening for her, because she had to be very careful not to say anything, remembering not to say anything that would make them question her or whatever, to give away. If they walked through town, we would rather go behind the house and not be very visible. So that's the kind of things I remember.
How long did that go on for, that kind of life?
3 years. Till May 44. From 2 years with the Russians, and then 3 years with the Germans. Maybe it was 45. Yes, but not the Germans capitulated on the 8th of May 1945. So I think the Russians came a bit earlier there. And that was a very memorable day for me, because we ran to meet them. The Russian soldiers had sung beautifully the army songs. They were with the accordion, and we heard it throughout when they were coming nearer, and they were in the forest. We could hear them. And then there was sort of a bunch of soldiers walking toward us, and my mother ran up to one of them, and she said to him, "I am Jewish, Ya Ivreika in Russian." And he said, and I still remember the phrase, which I can say in Russian, "One thing the Germans did a good job is that they killed the Jews." And then she said, "I am Jewish." And then she came back to us and she said, "It's not over, children." So we just, from then on, we just weren't really living a proper Jewish life. And I still don't.
Did you stay in that village in that area?
No, I think shortly after that my mother had some kind of notion that she will go and we went to Brest, Litovsk, because we thought we can move to our house or whatever, but it was still confiscated, and we stayed for a while with a woman who used to work as a maid for my parents, who was very kind and gave us shelter. And I think my mother gave her all the furniture that were stored somewhere or whatever. And we supported ourselves. My mother baked bread, and my sister and I used to go to the market to sell it. And that didn't last that long, because we went to live in Łódź from then, which was... It was another day of my birthday, because we were traveling, I suppose, a distance which shouldn't take more than, at the most, 6 hours, for about 4 days, in kind of wagons, from Brest-Litovsk to Łódź. And it was a very, it's a cattle wagon. There were animals. But it was nice.
Before we go on to your life after the war, I wondered if you remembered yourself seeing the Russians for the first time when they come into the village. Did you go and meet them yourself?
Yes, I was with my mother. I remember that. Well, there was, in spite of that remark, anti-Semitic remark, there was an enormous feeling of relief, because they were nasty and they didn't like Jews, but they weren't going to kill, they weren't killing them. And there were rumors about soldiers raping women, and but nobody in that village got raped. And they gave us sweets, and they gave us chocolate, and they gave us things. And we were not afraid. At night, we didn't wait for the banging on the door to say, go to Auschwitz, go to, we are taking you away.
Had there been any other, were there any other Jews hiding that you knew of?
I vaguely remember there was a Jew who was living sort of wild, who was hiding in the forest, probably with the help of Polish and Russian partisan, because of the area they were both. And he came one night. I suspect that the man who let us live in his house maybe knew something. Maybe he was just a good man, because this man, who didn't say that he was a Jew, came to get washed and shave in the middle of the night. And we saw him as this bearded, dirty, smelly man, and he was given hot water and he was fed. And then later our mother said to us that he was Jewish, and we didn't know how, but you know, one Jew recognized the other. She had the second, the sense of, and I think that was the only person. Various, I remember one family with whom we lived during this time when the Russian came, German came. We sort of had contacts with them, and I heard a lot about them. It was a family called Kirstein from Wysokie Litewskie. They all died rather badly. He was a dentist. They had 2 children, and I think I heard from my sister about them, because they had a son who was, maybe gave my sister a kiss for the first time or something like that. And they were shot very quickly.
Were you aware during the war of a place called Auschwitz, or what was happening to other Jews?
At the end of the war, there was a sort of whispering about concentration camps. I heard words like Majdanek and Oświęcim, how much the grown-ups knew about what's going on, I don't know. But we knew they were dangerous places where people were taken, where the Jews were taken away. And it was one of the reasons we were going through all these charades to not to get there, because we knew, my mother must have known that there were executions, and although Germans were not frequently, but it happened that the partisans or somebody would shoot the German. And one of the things that the Germans did, and I think it happened in Narev, that a German was shot, and they would take a veterinary surgeon to be shot as a reciprocation, or the so-called prominent people. So there were some shootings around about it. Yes, I'm sure we knew about concentration camps. That was the ultimate threat. Yes.
And we've just come to the end of the second tape there.
Oh, good. So maybe that's it.
And this is tape number 3 of the interview with Mrs. Adela Boddy. When you left the village that you'd been hiding in for the last time, did anybody know then that you'd been Jews hiding?
No. No. Just in case it wasn't safe. This phrase went with us for a very long time.
Which phrase was that?
It's not safe. Better if less people know. Maybe my mother mentioned to somebody she really trusted, but I don't think so. I don't think so. It changed eventually when we got to Łódź, which was majority of Jews who survived went to Łódź, because Warsaw was ruined. Krakow Jewish district was completely obliterated. There was nothing to return. And Łódź became sort of a focal point, not just for Jews, but the life was theater, cinema, everything was starting from Łódź. And Jews started coming back, and even from other parts of Poland. And so we went there. So in some ways, being a Jew wasn't such a dangerous thing anymore.
Was there any anti-Semitism, though, in Łódź after the war when the Jews came back?
In 1947, there was the massacre of the Jews in the, forget momentarily, but it's a well-known historical fact. There was some trouble with... Christian child died, and the rumor was spread. The interpretation of it is very complicated. Apparently, the rumor was spread that the Jews, who were about 60 Jews in this completely Jewish town before the war, that they killed the baby for matzah, and a riot started, and Jews were killed and thrown into the river. Some people say that now that it was inspired by the communists, whatever. I don't know the reasons, but The news about it spread very quickly, and my mother and a lot of other Jewish families thought that it would be very quickly picked up, that the movement will spread. And I remember staying in Łódź already when we got there, not going out for 2 days until we heard on the radio and from other people who were coming, or, you know, the networking, that it was safe and there was not going to be any trouble in Łódź. But it was a frightening thing to be a Jew. In Poland, the anti-Semitism was part of daily life. Nothing that a British person or somebody from big cities like New York can imagine, or even Hollywood, where Jews are in strength, that it is not, you know, it's maybe like being white in Harlem. I don't know what kind of comparison to make. So we lived quite schizophrenic life after the war. We were Jews with Jews, and we weren't Jewish with non-Jews.
Did you keep any holidays? Did you keep Shabbat?
No. But we went, we had friends. My mother made friends. We lived, we were, in Łódź we were taken in, because there was a shortage of housing, by a woman who had one room, no bathroom and kitchen. And we stayed, she had a son, she was Jewish, blonde Jewish with Polish name. She took us in, and we lived in this one room. The boy with whom I was growing up lives in Queens, outside New York. We are still friends, and we are trying to find out how we did our, what did we do about our physiological needs? How did we wash? But obviously we must have. He has some theory or not.
You don't remember?
I don't remember much about it. I'm sure we got washed, and it wasn't a traumatic thing, otherwise I would remember.
What did your mother do?
After the war? Yes,
she
went to, with this woman, Helena Nowacka, who, by the way, she survived in Warsaw, on Aryan papers. All her whole family was killed, except her son, who is my one of my best friends since the 40s. He survived the war in the couch. He was just all day in the couch, and at night they would let him out. The family that sheltered them, he brought them to the States and did all the right things, but his spine is twisted. My mother and Helena, my friend Andrzej's mother, they opened a little shop in which they sold. No, they first started going to Germany, smuggling food to Germany, because Germany was in trouble, there was hunger, and bringing anything and selling it. So that way they accumulated some capital. And we were actually very well off for a short period when they were running this thing. And the three of us, my sister and Andrzej, who is a year younger than me, I don't think we had what you would call normal childhood, because these women from the market would come to buy the stuff that, and they would give us vodka and things like that.
Were you going to school?
Yes, and I started going to school, to this primary, Catholic primary school.
Was that your first school?
That was my first school. I suspect that the school was chosen by me because I became friendly with a girl in the street, and so that's how it went.
And were you known as Jewish at that school?
No, no. I went to confession. And I became friends with a girl who was Jewish. I didn't know she was Jewish. And we decided at some point that we were tired of inventing sins because we had to go to confession every week. You know how it is. And so we stopped, we looked. We were very independent, we were very young, but our mothers, or this girl was an orphan. We just made decisions, like changing school was a decision without... My mother was told that I was moving to another school, which we liked better because there was no religion. So that's how it was.
Did you ever feel that it was important for you, although you were going to a Catholic school, to keep being Jewish somehow?
We were Jewish. This was not removed. It was just continuation of the war routine to camouflage, to be careful. I don't tell my colleagues at work that I'm Jewish. I don't tell them that I'm not Jew, that I'm not a Jew. I just don't tell them anything. Maybe some of them know because I open my mouth. I make my point clear if the Jews are attacked or somebody's anti-Semitic, which doesn't happen very often in Scotland. Mostly it's my Polish colleagues who also work there. Scots don't voice their prejudices, or maybe they don't have it. So it's never a problem.
Why don't you tell people, though?
I don't know. It's a habit. Maybe I'm afraid they'll fire me. I don't know. I don't want to be called a Jew behind my back. I just don't know.
Do you think that would happen? Do you think?
Probably not. It's totally irrational. My children were quite old. They were in their... I think my younger daughter was 12 when I actually said... they always knew there was something. I used to tell them stories like... the same stories which I told my mother-in-law, who's a good Episcopalian or Presbyterian, that my father was Jewish but my mother wasn't. In other words, it was post-war story kind of thing. And then I told my older daughter and she said, don't be silly, I always knew there was something funny about your stories. And my younger daughter said, oh yes, fine. So, but, and I suppose I told my, I never told my husband. I also told my husband the cockeyed story that I was only half Jewish in New York when I met him.
Does he know now? Have you told him?
I told him one day, maybe not long ago, I said, by the way, you know, all these stories are lies. And he said, don't you think I knew it? Why? What's wrong with you? Do you think I'm stupid? In other words, it was not important to anybody, but it's a problem for me.
Is your husband Jewish?
No, no.
When did you leave Poland?
I left Poland in 1959.
And why was that? Why did you decide to leave?
Well, I was... I actually left beginning of 1960, sorry. I was very disillusioned with my political activities because by that time I knew, we all knew about Stalin's atrocity. So the, all this promise of the better life became. And then I wasn't very happy. Also, my mother was pushing me to... My sister married a Pole. We were going to emigrate to Israel in 1953, like most Jews. And then my sister met... She was a student, and she met him while she was in school. And she said to my mother, Jewish boy will never marry me because they want blonde girls with upturned noses, and she didn't have it. So, and she was in love, and my mother said, well, he asked her to marry her. She was 18. She's still married to him. And my mother, instead of leaving her in Poland and going with me to Israel, we stayed. But then she kind of felt that I should, if I have an opportunity, I should leave and then bring them out. So,
what sort of life had you had in Poland up until you left? Because what sort of life did you have?
It was a very hard life. My mother worked very hard. Her health was very poor. She had, you know, shaking hands at very early age. But she worked hard. But it wasn't bad. We had free education, and it was expected that we go to university and not to go to work at the age of 16. My sister went to study medicine. She's, by the way, very involved lately in the sort of, there is a new wave of interest in these Holocaust children, and there are very few of them. And she just found out at one of her meetings, she met a neighbor. She lives in this house for about 20 years, same staircase, apartment block. Just my point. And they didn't know that they were Jewish.
Your sister didn't know the name?
The other woman. But now they do things together, and it's very different.
What did you study at university?
I did law in Łódź. And it was a very exciting time, post-war 1950s. There was the very famous Łódź Film School, and I was very sort of outgoing person, and I was hobnobbing with the likes of like Polanski and the other filmmakers, Haas, and can't think of Vida. I wasn't quite a groupie, but I had boyfriends who were in film school, so I brushed my shoulders with the famous and could see American films before everybody else.
So, and this was in communist Poland?
It was in communist Poland, who had a kind of elite of youth that could combine being good communists and just do their own things. I had a very good time.
Were you a good communist?
I stopped. When did Khrushchev came about? I forgot. 56 was the Party Congress or something like that. Yes, from then on I just lost interest, or I grew out of it. I just wasn't anymore ideologically oriented. I think I'm still fairly left-wing in a kind of different way, and that's something that you don't lose, except it becomes more sort of controlled. But I still have sympathies for certain things that they did, like eroded illiteracy. And, you know, education was free for everyone. Mothers had kindergartens, and there was certain equality. There was shortage of men, so women did all kinds of jobs. They probably got less paid But the issue of feminism wasn't an issue because women just did men's job and vice versa. So I found it very rewarding and pleasing. But somehow or other, I was talked into leaving, and I went to New York in the early 60s, and it was another exciting time. It's a great time.
What did you do in New York?
I went to... I immediately enrolled at Columbia University for English courses, and then I took a course in what was called area studies. It was master's postgraduate course, which I nearly finished, but I didn't because I married a Scotsman who was working there. My husband was working for the New York Health Board for 3 years. And we met there. Yes, it was very different from the Jewish point of view to be surrounded by Jews in such quantities who had this immense self-assurance and would never dream of not being Jewish or not saying. I think that kind of restored my confidence to a degree, but not entirely, not entirely. I think I would need years of psychoanalysis or whatever to get out of this.
Were you living in a Jewish part of New York?
No, I didn't, but Manhattan was pretty Jewish and this sort of intelligentsia. It was mixed, it wasn't entirely Jewish. My friends were not Orthodox. They were students or they were young researchers or whatever. I worked for all kinds of... My English was very poor. My first job was for a Jewish firm. And I think I met Jewish people from the Delancey Street part of Manhattan, who gave me names, and I think they helped me with getting a job. But my first job was winding up watches, and I was spending too much. It was a German Jew firm. They didn't like it. I was escaping to the toilet a lot because it was so boring. I had to check the watches one day to wind them and the next day to make sure. So that didn't last long. I had a very nice job for a law firm as a filing clerk, but I kept misfiling. But they actually were willing. They told me to go away for a year, learn English, come back, and they were going to send me to law school, and I thought I couldn't do it too long. So.
When did you come to live in Scotland?
I came to Scotland in 1965. I got married in 65 and came here.
We haven't said your husband's name yet. What's your husband's name?
Andrew.
And his surname?
Boddy. Andrew Boddy. Andrew F. Boddy.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have two children, two wonderful daughters whose photographs are behind me.
And what are their names?
They are absolutely wonderful. My older daughter is called Kasia. Katrina, Scottish Katrina, but we call her by their Polish. She was renamed by my sister, Kasia. And my younger daughter, Janet. And they both... Well, Kasia went to Edinburgh University, like her father, who did medicine there. Kasia started medicine and for 3 weeks and moved herself to English. And she's now teaching American literature in UCL. Janet stayed home with me till she finished her psychology course in Glasgow, went and got her PhD in London. Kasia went to Cambridge, got her PhD, and both of them live in London. And I'm very proud of them.
Any grandchildren?
Not yet, not yet.
Were there any other effects on you, do you think, in later life?
From the
war? From the childhood that you had to go through?
I think I was extremely overprotective mother. Always looking for dangers. Always worrying that somebody is not going to come home when they were 2 minutes late. Always checking on safety. It's still there. Always jumping if there was a noise or a knock. Heart would start pumping. I don't think about it. You know, this is such and so many years, but it's there. It's always there. My sister has the same thing. Always frightened. Always not frightened, but ready. So she lives the same kind of stupid life as I do, not here and not there. But her son, who is brought up and Christian and baptized, went to Israel and became very Jewish for a while. It's there, but I think it was important for him to sort of find out a little bit about Jewish culture and meet Jews in quantities. Loved it. That's how it is. My best friend, who died recently in Glasgow, was Jewish, a woman from Cockney, East End of London, very nice person. But I think it was coincident. It wasn't the reason.
So, as we're coming to the end of the interview here, is there anything you'd like to say that you haven't had the opportunity to say yet?
Yes, I would like to say that although I'm doing this interview, and I'm happy to do it mostly in order to get the tape, although I think if I wasn't filmed in that fashion, I would probably, my daughters probably have much more insightful stories about my life to my past than this, because there is something inhibiting about talking to a camera. I have my reservations about this kind of exercise. What purpose do they serve? Whether they are actually of historical value, or whether they satisfy emotional needs of people who want to do that. And I would be inclined to agree with the second. There was a conference here on Yiddish theater in Europe, in Glasgow, which was mainly attended by playwriters and theater directors from Israel, Germany, and the States. And somehow, during one of my sort of public speaking, I know what it was. The theater in Israel was criticized, or the young generation of people in Israel was criticized, who were saying to their parents or grandparents, enough already of Holocaust. And the Americans were outraged at this attitude. And I was not in sympathy with the American view. That's all what I want to say. I'm ambivalent about fulfilling emotional needs through other people's thing, maybe because I'm still the sort of remaining people who actually lived through, and I feel that maybe it is exploitative a bit. But on the other hand, I'm not the other person, so I don't know. My children experienced the Holocaust and my life through my stories. Yet they have no guilt about it, no need for reinforcement. This has happened. They acknowledge the sadness which reflects on their life, because if I'm sad, they're sad. But they don't, when they go to Poland, they never ever want to go to Auschwitz. They don't have the need to see the monuments or the cemetery where so many people died. They know it happened. They don't need to see it. And I was very strong in reinforcing this attitude. And I'm pleased to say that I'm successful.
Mrs. Boddy, thanks very much indeed. We've just come to the end of the tape there.
Good. Great.
This is tape 4 of the interview with Mrs. Adela Boddy. Tell me about this picture we're looking at here, Ada. Who are these people?
This is a picture of my mother, Eugenia, Genia Wirszupska, and my father, Aaron. I suspect this is their wedding photograph.
Where was that taken?
In Vilno, Vilnius. I have the date of their marriage, which I think was either 1929, probably 1929. Photograph on the left, not yet.
Tell me about this picture of the lady on her own on the left there.
This is a photograph of my grandmother, Mrs. Dvorak or Mrs. Borisevich, later in life, at the cash desk, I think, of the bathhouse in Vilnius, which is on Zavalna Street, which my sister visited quite recently.
And do you know when this picture was taken?
In the 30s, somewhere.
And what was your grandmother's first name?
I don't remember. I'm sorry.
Tell me about this picture here, the three adults and the two children.
This is a picture taken probably quite shortly before the war. Could be 37, 38, or beginning of 39 even. On the picture, on the left of the picture is my father, Aaron. In the middle, my aunt, my mother's sister, Aunt Nura. And then there is my mother.
What is Nura's surname?
She had a very short-lived marriage, so she would be Dvorak, like her mother. I don't know her married name. At the bottom of the picture, there is my
What's
sister.
What's your mother's name? Sorry.
My mother's name, Genia or Eugenia. My sister's name, Regina or Renia. And myself, the younger of the two children. Okay?
Tell me about this picture here, Ada. Who are we seeing here?
These are my mother's sisters, three sisters, and one of her brothers. The sister starting from the left of the photograph is Gita, then is Cila, and then the brother was called Fimka, and the youngest of the children, her youngest sister, Ola.
And what was their surname?
Dvorak.
Could you spell that for me?
D-V-O-R-A-K.
And where was this taken?
This was taken in Vilnius. Also probably late 30s.
And did any of them survive?
None of them survived. Nobody survived.
And that's the end of the fourth tape and the end of the interview with Mrs. Boddy.